the children's window is genuinely today to help launch the safety awareness month. The month will include a number of overlapping special weeks which highlight the problems and solutions in water safety, bushfire prevention, bicycle safety, motorcycle safety and multiple sclerosis. When it's considered that thousands of people are killed or maimed in accidents each year, Regional Manager of the National Safety Council, Jerry Darcy, says that a campaign like this is well worthwhile. He says it's not only the human cost that's devastating, but the financial burden that must be borne by the rest of the community.
Show that for every person in Australia, it costs us $40 per week to cover the costs of the accidents. That is the medical costs and the time off costs and the loss of and the insurance costs, etc. $40 per week per head. That comes out at $10 billion per year.
The race got underway at 2:30 this afternoon in good sailing conditions. Among the field were some of the top 16-foot skiffs from Sydney and Lake Macquarie, using the race as preparation for the state and Australian championships later this year. The course went from in front of the Belmont 16-footers club, around Warners Bay and Spears Point, and back to the club. First across the line was the current Australian champion Dennis Tenko from St George in Sydney in Esprit Light Cooler. Highlight of yesterday's Warbirds on Parade air show at Scone was the Royal Australian Air Force's latest addition, the FA-18 Hornet. Warbirds are classed as any aircraft used by the military as a trainer, bomber or a fighter. And if you closed your eyes, the mere sound of these mighty planes sent you back in time. Organisers say the 12,000 plane buffs visited Scone yesterday to see these old birds in flight, and the enthusiasts weren't disappointed. There were displays from tiger moths, mustangs, chipmunks and Grumman trackers, just to name a few. Scone is rapidly gaining a reputation as a centre for warbirds, but if you missed yesterday's spectacular, these nostalgic aircraft will be making a repeat performance at the NBN Air Spectacular at Rutherford in 2 weeks' time.
Newcastle District, 100 highway police have been working over the long weekend. Up until last night, 230 speeding tickets had been issued. However, overall, police say they're pleased with the behaviour of motorists.
Highway police are expecting traffic congestion up until early tomorrow morning, and they've urged motorists to take into consideration the overcast conditions and the heavy volume of traffic on the roads.
Can you platers have been doing continuing repair work for parts on Australia's Oberon submarines for the past 6 years. However, it has just built a new plant on its Georgetown site to enable it to repair submarine crankshafts like these. Company spokesman Scott Ginninen said because conventional engines are being put in the new submarines, it's likely that they will be able to do repair work on the components that they have become specialists in. He is adamant that their submarine repair work does not depend on Newcastle getting the submarine contract. He said components are simply sent to the areas which specialise in fixing them.
So they're all out of submarines, is that right?
This particular shaft here is, and we have another one here at the moment, but we have some other crankshafts out of diesel locomotives and large stationary engines.
Are you hoping to be able to do the same sort of repair work on the new subs?
We'd hope so. They're putting conventional engines in the submarine, so they will have the same wear problems. So I guess every 5 to 10 years each submarine will have to be refitted and the shafts will be coming out of them.
To get rid of the wear and damage by drying it. It is then plated, which builds it back up to its original specifications. In the final stage, it is finished ground. Then, using optical procedures for checking alignment, which were pioneered by Newcastle University's research association, the crankshaft alignment for precision check.
That'll cheat it enough.
Hello, I'm Mark Matho, and tonight on NBN News, I'll report on a major new sponsorship deal for the 1987 Newcastle show. The Shortland County Council today announced that the show will be sponsored for $20,000, part of a change of corporate image for the authority.
Join Ray Dineen and Anna Manzoni for all the news tonight at 6.
Unsuitable for use in the long term. However, for financial reasons, the school has never been moved and instead has been refurbished with rejected equipment and teaching aids from other schools. But students say even basic upkeep of facilities has been neglected and they're now fed up.
We take a model to the basin, shampoo the hair, and the water goes on the floor and it seeps through the floor onto the room below. It's just, it's so old and antiquated. It was originally a building that was just to be temporary, and we've been here for 90 years or more, and same with the equipment is temporary, but it's broken, it's obsolete, it's just crazy. We can't operate professionally in a building like this.
Amongst holes in panes and holes in floors, substandard equipment is one of the things that students say they have to put up with. This model in particular, they're expected to do sets and hairstyles on this.
Vicky Thompson, proprietor of Newcastle Salon Headliners, agrees that there's been a problem at the school for some time.
I'm generally concerned because I send, at the moment, I've got 8 students attending the college, and I'd like to feel that once they go down there that their day spent there has been totally worthwhile and that they have learnt something. If the equipment and the premises aren't up to standard, well, am I better off keeping them in the salon that day?
But it seems students and teachers may not have to put up with that situation for too much longer. Late this afternoon, Education Minister Rod Cavalier announced that $1.6 million will be spent on renovating the old electrical trades building in Wood Street for use as a new school of hairdressing. Construction is expected to begin before the end of this year and to be completed for the last term of next year.
Were alerted when the 65-year-old pensioner and angina sufferer hadn't returned to his curry home from a trail bike expedition. By Wednesday, he was still missing, and a full-scale land and air search involving Polair, the Westpac rescue helicopter, and 100 personnel were called in to search 120 square kilometres of the district surrounding Curry. By late yesterday afternoon, the chances of finding the man alive grew dim. Today, the search, one of the biggest in the region's history, was scaled down. Just after 10 o'clock this morning, the body of William Foster was discovered in bushland behind the Curry Sewage Works, his trail bike nearby. At this stage, police believe he died of a heart attack. A post-mortem is now taking place.
The peace and quiet of the Murray Golf Course at Raymond Terrace is a good environment for human beings and an equally good environment for koalas. In fact, it's one of the few places in the Port Stephen Shire where man and marsupial happily coexist. The Shire boasts probably the largest, most widespread and healthiest wild koala population in New South Wales. But suburban growth is eating into koala country. The National Parks and Wildlife Service is distributing cards to the public as part of a statewide survey of koala numbers, distribution and health. Experts say that habitat destruction and disease is killing off our most loved marsupial at an alarming rate. Senior Ranger John Trudgeon says the survey is the first step towards reversing the trend, but that it depends on help from the public.
Well, firstly, they can participate in the survey that's being undertaken, which will give us a much clearer picture as to distribution and possible health problems. We can, through the public, try and ensure that wildlife corridors and sufficient areas of feed trees are left for the koala populations.
It was standing room only at the Hempstead Bowling Club as a panel of politicians and four-wheel drive officials led a discussion on the proposed Wilderness and Wild Rivers Act. The Minister for Environment and Planning, Bob Carr, has extended the deadline for submissions on this most controversial act until early December. Today was to be the closing day for public comment. The four-wheel drivers say the legislation, if passed, will deny peaceful access by thousands of New South Wales citizens to our natural heritage. The Land Use Officer for the New South Wales Four-Wheel Drive Association, John Gregg, in addressing the meeting, also contended that the closure of the current parklands will place a further burden on those remaining open. Mr. Gregg says the association has drafted a thorough, hard-hitting, 100-page submission to put before the minister.
So we're pointing out to him what the four-wheel drive clubs are all about. We've done a profile of the average member through surveys. We've looked at the economic impact of four-wheel driving, and we've looked in detail at the report itself, the report of the Wilderness Working Group, and we've made certain conclusions from all that and made certain recommendations to him.
Those recommendations include spreading the impact of use by extending access, not locking areas up as proposed, educating recreational users of wilderness areas through public campaigns, and the formation of a structured use management plan to preserve and maintain the areas in question.
Station, a high school band playing and a crowd of regular commuters on hand to mark the line's birthday. The railing between Toronto and Fassifern started as a tram line, but now carries a two-car diesel service. The line operates at a loss, and the State Rail Authority has in the past considered closing it down. Today's celebrations aimed at showing the support the service has, and some use the occasion to call for electrification of the line.
Go! Oh, it was a very even start.
See the return of the solo bikes.
Wilmot tries to come across the front of the leader, Wilmot got the better of Watson as they go into turn one, Dixon's coming at him very strongly too, going down the back straight away, Sean Wilmot from England's leader, followed by Chris Watson, then comes Brian Dixon, right round the outside goes Dixon, he's drifted out very wide though, Dixon has lost a lot of ground, Sean Wilmot the leader,
delighting the many fans, look at Dixon
coming back at Watson though, he's certainly got some herbs down the main, down the straightaways has Brian Dixon.
We'll highlight the solos.
But
right
with a lap, Luxon was in one heck also of a mess. But play on, card, calls we'll the Chief Steward. And down the back straight away, the it's the number three car on Ron Lethem who races away. Look at Brewer and John Pine coming now, out. Gee, these Ron Lethem and Ken Johnson, they've been caged Robertson up all winter. All they want to do is cut loose. And they're doing it. Ron Lethem's out in front. He leads.
Policy was released today by the Minister for Technology and Industry, Senator John Button, and announced in Newcastle by the federal member, Alan Morris. Mr. Morris said the 30% subsidy would be offered for work on ships of more than 6,000 tonnes involved in international trade. Senator Button said $6 million will be made available for the package over the next 3 years, and strict criteria concerning codes of business and industrial relation practices would apply. Acting General Manager of the State Dockyard, Bob Cox, says the policy is the result of a three-year review involving government representatives, ship repairers, owners and the ACTU. Mr. Cox says the policy and the devalued dollar will help attract work to Newcastle away from our major competitor, Singapore. Managing Director of Varley's Engineering, Clem Varley, says the bounty is similar to those already in operation overseas. But he says Australia's remoteness from the world's major shipping routes remains the major hurdle for local repair facilities. Both Clem Varley and Bob Cox agree that the bounty policy is a positive step, but they also maintain that subsidies alone are not enough, and they say Australian shipbuilders and repairers should continue to develop a keen competitive edge on the international market.
Orchestra.
Well, why has the Parry Foundation decided to give this grant to the orchestra?
The orchestra has achieved much in the Hunter in the short time of its existence, but it's going to expand. Its influence will be right up and down the Hunter and I think beyond, and we feel that it needs this additional finance to enable it to usefully undertake some of this extensive work that's in prospect for the future.
The money will secure the December season. The Hunter Orchestra's administrator, Anne Smith, and chairman, Professor David Frost, say the sponsorship has come at a crucial time.
We'll have the money to risk running a fourth orchestral season this year. And so it's really the money to fund our activities for the rest of the year.
And what about the future years? How do they look?
Well, things look good. We've just heard yesterday that we have Australia Council grants for next year. We hope to pick up New South Wales Ministry for the Arts grants. Sponsorship comes in all the time and the enterprise is growing, so we hope to have a successful 1987.
Sunny conditions brought out a goodly number of spectators to walk the course with their favourite from the 15 golfers that earned the right to play for the title. Each starter had won their club championship to make it into the field. Yvonne Beattie of the Steelworks Club won the title for the first time with rounds of 81 and 85 for a total of 136. Yvonne was an outstanding junior player who dropped out of the game for some years, but since returning has shown the ability she always possessed. She formerly played with the Maitland Club. She is the first Steelworks golfer to win since Carol Morgan did so some 20 years ago.
It's a nice straight shot, lovely shot.
Second home was local player Doreen Edwards, who went into the match as favourite, having won this championship on four previous occasions. She had the best opening round of 80, but fell away with an 88 in the afternoon. It was a tie for third between Carol and Paulie of the Newcastle Club and Del Wilson of Curry Curry.